helping you navigate the rocky path of fulfilling employment. Here's our career Sherpa, Julie Bauke.
Yes, sir, on this short show, because we have Reds baseball, 11:35, first punch at 12:35 today on 700 WOW Reds and Pirates. Julie Bauke is our career Sherpa, as already stated, and we have a list in front of us here. The five most annoying things you can do in the office. These are the things that are the most annoying things you or your colleagues can do, which is a subject of contention. I mean, you know, we often talk about generally boss or employee-employer relations, Julie, but coworker-coworker relations, especially when they do things that kind of annoy you, get under your skin, those things tend to build and make you not want to come to work.
What struck me about this list was the first three are all about food.
There's no question. Because that's the common denominator.
Things we do with food.
Yeah. Let's just go through the list here. I'm going to start with, let's go from least offensive to most offensive and go backwards on this. 24%, so one in four workers roughly, say colleagues whistling or singing. I can't think of too many colleagues I have that walk around singing or whistling.
Or how about humming? Mm-hmm. That's another one. That making noise. How about just, singing, whistling, making extraneous noises that don't have anything to do with work. I'm sure that can really get on your nerves, which is why so many people work with earbuds in or AirPods
Right. We had a guy that would constantly clear his throat and years ago. It was almost like Tourette's.
Yeah.
And that kind of sort of annoyed people.
I think most people who kind of had that unconscious habit of singing, humming, whistling, whatever it is, they probably aren't even aware they're doing it.
Like a nervous
so
habit.
So maybe bringing it to their attention really.
I think it's probably like talking to yourself, right? Like people go, things like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, could be.
What about speaking too loudly? 27% of workers say that is the most annoying thing in the office. Speaking too loudly, they would have a horrible time here at 700 WLW simply because the guy on after me. What do you mean be quiet? I can't be quiet. This is how I talk. I've got on and I've got off and I'm a great American.
So does he talk like that when he's not on the radio?
All
too?
The time.
Okay.
Yes. And then he'll up and down, screaming up and down the hall.
Earbuds?
Segman! Yes. Screaming. You would not get along well at 700 WLW. Well, we all talk loudly because we're deaf from years of wearing headphones. So if you hate loud talkers, people come into our building, honestly, and it's disconcerting for them because they come in, maybe clients, potential clients, things like that. And people work in really nice button-down offices, P&G, Fifth Third Bank, Great American Insurance, and they come in here and it's like people are screaming at the top of their lungs at each other. Not in bad ways, just because that's how we talk.
Yeah, well, that's just the type of personality that I think a radio station or media can attract.
Yes.
And if you're not comfortable being loud and putting your thoughts and your voice out there, you're probably not going to be successful in that field. So if you're looking for a tranquil workplace, I agree. Apply elsewhere.
Now, as bad as that is, 27% of colleagues speak too loudly. This is the top five behaviors office workers find most irritating. Also at 27%, colleagues eating too loudly.
There's actually, and I don't know the name of it, there's actually a condition that, that you can't stand the sound of people chewing. It's not like a phobia, but it's like there's a name for it, the sound of people chewing.
Yes, I know what you mean.
Drives you crazy.
What drives me crazy is the soft whisper talking, trying to, there's something about like that EDSM stuff that's on what people, the oral, what I am probably, what I'm talking about? There's a commercial on for, I think it's Michelob Ultra, debuted during the Super Bowl, and says this lady who's sitting in the middle of the forest with mountains behind her, and she's doing that with a bottle of beer. I got to turn it off because it drives me crazy.
I know. I don't have enough brain cells to focus on
people
that kind of
eating
stuff.
A lot. Let me just tell you something. Cells. Julie Bauke, today or tomorrow, tomorrow's Thursday, tomorrow is Ron's Roost Day. One of the great things Ron's Roost does outside of their freshly fried chicken is bring Saratoga chips in. And Saratoga chips are notoriously crunchy.
Yeah.
And the entire newsroom.
You?
No, it doesn't bother me because usually I'm gone by then. But I hear reports out of the newsroom that some workers will eat chips so loudly it sounds like an earthquake, Seg. What about that? Chips being eaten too loud. I mean, literally, you walk in and it sounds like it might be the big one in California. That's what it sounds like. Jules, you there?
If I'm
no, your phone's. You got a crappy phone again. What's going on? You can afford a better phone than this.
No, it's not me. It's you. how about popcorn eaters behind you in movies?
Oh, yeah.
Sometimes they're like, nom, nom,
does that bug you? I really never pay attention to it. Once the movie starts,
popcorn,
it drowns it out.
Right. Sometimes it does. Now, it doesn't bother me as much as people talking in movies, which seems to be more of a thing now, which is why people, I think, watch more movies at home. But it's that if you're not eating or chewing or crunching or whatever it is and somebody else is, I think that can get on your nerves. But I usually say to myself, we're in a movie. I'm in a public place. People bought popcorn. Get over it. And I focus something else. But when you're at work, especially if you've got people who are like, nah, nah, you know, making noises
other than just plain old
chewing. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I mean, I'm sure some people are bothered by plain old chewing. But the other part of that is, if people are like smacking their lips and making extraneous chewing noises, you know, that sort of stuff, that's going to get on anybody's
mouth. Popping your lips. So, well, it's kind of like like in a newsroom, Willie's great-granddaughter, Libby Cunningham, she has this thing where she gets a straw because, you know, women and lipstick, I guess, whatever. But anyway, she gets her Diet Coke and she will not stop slurping the bottom of that. And then if she gets ice, forget about it. Isn't that crazy?
She must have learned something from great-grandpa,
I guess. Slurping and slurping and slurp. Stop already. Stop.
Yeah,
it's terrible.
It's empty.
I'm not even going to start about Matt Reese. Wait till you hear all the stuff that guy does.
I thought all your problems were gone now that Jeff Henderson had retired.
Well,
he
was forced out because of he'd bring egg salad in and stink up the whole building.
No.
Every day. I'm going to have egg salad. Egg salad
is something I can't even think about it. Ugh.
The top five most irritating habits for office workers find, we've got whistling, singing, speaking too loudly, eating someone else's food. This is a good one.
Okay, I don't even get why that's a thing. And I'm assuming what they mean by that is taking someone's food out of the refrigerator, not just walking by and grabbing somebody's chip off their plate.
No question.
But what is that? I mean, on my worst day, I mean, I would never, I don't get that. But it is apparently a big office problem. People stealing other people's food. This one baffles me that's even a thing.
I won't even put, if I brought food in, which I don't, but if I brought food in, I wouldn't even put it in the refrigerator. God knows what kind of HIV, Ebola, some sort of weird. Every office refrigerator is flat out disgusting. I wouldn't put a sealed can in there for fear that whatever kind of nastiness is going to permeate the metal on the outside of that can and get in there. You know what I'm saying? It's just putting food in there is gross, let alone going, oh, here's a stranger's sandwich. I wonder what this, I'm going to come and eat this. And you go, how do I know that they, you know, they didn't just set stuff on, you know, the counter, how they made the sandwich in the first place? Or it could be something disgusting. Yeah. Oh, this is terrible. Why would I'm not taking that kind of chance.
Yeah, but if you look in there and say there's a little lunch kit or one of those little things or a brown paper bag and it says Bob on the outside, you're like, oh, I'm sure Bob won't mind if I root through his lunch and steal his sandwich and his apple.
Right.
I mean, I hear that often enough that it baffles me for the reason you said, for sure. Like, do you really want, you don't know what's in there, but just the fact that it's somebody else's lunch, it's not yours. Come on. I mean, I don't know. But that's like number two, isn't it? So it must be
number two.
It must be happening.
Well, I got a way to stop that. I had that happen to me. You want my story?
You put a salmonella-laced chicken salad sandwich in the refrigerator?
No, I'm not that bad. So
okay.
I'd like in the morning, I set my desk, I'd put an apple on it. I'd probably have like an apple like later or save it. And then I noticed my apple a couple days and I was gone. I'm like, oh, that's kind of weird. Someone must want an apple. All right. Next I come in and apple's gone. Then someone took a bite of the apple and put it on.
No.
Yes.
Really?
So I know somebody's screwing with me. I'm like, okay, good.
Yeah.
Another apple, take a bite of it. Next day I bring an apple in. What they didn't know that morning is that I took that apple and I put it in the urinal in the men's room and picked it up by the stem and rolled around in the urinal, bottom of the urinal. And then I set it on a napkin on my desk. And of course, you know, everything that was on there dried and all that. And then the apple, of course, had a bite taken out of it. So then what I did is that I sent out an email all to everyone that would be around at that time in the building is a picture of the apple of the bite out of my desk and then next to a picture of that same apple in the urinal. Guess what didn't happen the next day?
Did you really do that?
Yes, I did. That's true.
Oh, true my story. Gosh. Yeah.
So well, there's for you. That's what you get. And I hope you got lupus or whatever it is you get from eating apples out of urinals.
Wow.
You deserve it.
All kinds of health crisis rumors here.
Well, believe me, every bad epidemic, pandemic we have starts here at iHeartMedia. I'm sure it emanates from the restroom to the kitchen areas and desk and whatever it is, the genes flip and we have all these nasty things, whether it's Ebola, you name it, it starts here.
Well, you know, I think that you might have single-handedly cured the listening audience of ever taking somebody else's food again just with that story.
Oh, I've got other stories.
Yeah, you've given people who have that same problem ideas. Mm-hmm. So food theft is, I think it's going to go away.
I'm an idea.
In Cincinnati.
You know what? I'm a think tank. I'm a one-man think
you
tank.
Are, you know what? You are a public servant.
I'm a
true public servant.
You know what? Yeah. I'm a national treasure. Julie Bakke, let me get to the number one thing on the list here where office workers find the most irritating, and that is colleagues eating smelly food in the office. 39% of people said that's it.
Yeah. When I saw that, all I could think of was I compared that to, since I don't work in an office of lots of other people, an airplane, you know, because you can bring your own food on.
Mm-hmm.
But, the worst was a guy who brought, I swear, it was a double garlic pizza onto an airplane, carrying it, you know, up above his head all through the plane, letting the garlic waft all over the plane, and then opened it up and started eating it. And now these are people who can't get up and move. You know, they can't go outside. They can't. So, yeah, same thing. It's when you cook something in a microwave or, you know, especially, I think that's especially it, when you bring something in and heat it up in the microwave, that's when it really seems to, when the little smell molecules go flying and land in every, you know, I think that seems to be the worst.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, I don't get that either. I mean, you have to have some consideration from the people around you. Nobody wants to smell your food.
You know, I wonder how that may work, because typically it tends to be ethnic foods that are really strong and pungent, Chinese food, Indian food, Italian food,
mm-hmm.
stuff like that, right? And how that works at in today's diverse workforce society, where you literally have H-1B workers that are coming over from India and other countries, and maybe they don't understand that. That's perfectly normal to them. How do you address that issue if someone's like, hey, you know, a strong curry dish, something that has, fish in it or something, that probably don't want to be heating that up in the microwave?
Well, I mean, it depends on the office space. So if you've got, like, a real lunchroom, eat it in the lunchroom. You know, you can't stop people from heating up their food in the microwave. But
no.
I do think consideration says eat it in the lunchroom, keep the smells contained. But we're all working at such a fevered pace that sometimes the only chance we get to eat, the only break we get is to go heat it up, whatever it is, and bring it back to our desk.
Right.
And then, you know, it's a smell that can permeate the rest of the day. But if you're the one who's eating it, you don't smell it. It's like you're the one who's chewing, you're not thinking about it. But
mm-hmm.
unless you're eating that item for lunch, you don't want to be smelling it all afternoon.
Yeah.
So just some thought, you know, just some general common courtesy, which doesn't seem to really
doesn't seem to be at all.
Supply.
No, that's true. And relative to that, I think it's. And I'm surprised this wasn't number one. What about the person who it seems like it's always one or two people that always do this, and that is burn popcorn on a microwave to the point where a lot of businesses have banned making popcorn.
Oh, that is the worst. That's the worst.
How the hell do you not stand there while the popcorn's being made and go, okay, this is unfamiliar microwave, or maybe I know the microwave work, and I'm not quite sure, because when I make it at home, it's 4 minutes, but here I put it on 4 minutes, and literally the smoke detectors are going off, and everyone can't breathe. But it's usually the same one or two people that do that all the time.
Yeah. And I think that probably falls into that number one, smelly food. But burnt popcorn might be the worst.
How do you keep burning the popcorn over and over? It's stand there and watch the popcorn. What's the last kernel pop? You hear a pop and there's 2 seconds between. Turn it off.
Exactly. I think people put the popcorn in.
I'm trying to get
3 minutes. Yeah. Run to the bathroom. Put their apple in the urinal. Bring it back. And then get their popcorn. And by then it's burnt.
Julie, the secret to a happy workplace is the old urinal apple.
It urine apple. We're calling it the urine apple.
Now, in HR, would I get yelled at? No, if this was under, you know, the dumpster fire that it is here at iHeartMedia Cincinnati, if I work in a real workplace, would I get in trouble for that?
For putting an apple in a urinal?
Yeah. It's my apple.
No, yeah, probably not.
How could I get yelled at for something that's like, apple. Did you give it to someone? No, I put it on my desk.
Yeah.
What do you care what I'm doing with the apple? It's my apple.
Exactly. You happen to like urine apple.
I'd be defined about it, going, no, I do it every day. I like my apple pre-coated.
Yeah.
That's how I roll.
Honestly,
I'm silly like
with
that.
You, right. That versus doing something that's truly going to harm somebody, that's just gross.
Mm-hmm.
But if you're putting a razor blade in the apple or something like that, that's a problem.
Well, that's a good idea. Yeah. Let me write that down. Julie says put apples and razor blades and apples.
And don't bring your kids to Sloaney's house for trick-or-treat.
Halloween, I was going to say. That sounds like something you could do at Halloween. Julie, we'll talk again next week. Julie Bauke from Bauke Group, our career coach at Bauke, B-A-U-K-E. That's thebaukegroup.com. Thanks again.